Can holler pretty loud too, can't I, Sister Manola? Still gotta praise God. All right, so take heed. Amen. Take heed how you what? How you build. Take heed how you build. Okay, I want you to go to another scripture here. It says this. I like this scripture a whole lot. It says this. Matthew 7:24-27. He says, therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine, and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man. This is Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew, verses 24-27. These are some really key scriptures. Now, some of you want to know why some people fail and why others prevail. It's the foundation that you're building on. Amen. It's the foundation that you're on. If you're the type of person that you don't take the word serious, if you're negligent, amen, in things which are designed to contribute to your foundation building, amen, praise God, you need to rethink, amen, your position this morning. It's the foundation that one builds on that makes the difference when the time of the storm, amen, really begins to come. Amen. That's what the scripture says. I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a what? Rock. The rain descended and the floods came and the winds did what? Blew and beat upon that house and it failed not, for it was founded upon a rock. All right, so you can see what it takes in order for you to be founded upon the rock. If you want that sure foundation, if you want, amen, to stand the forces of time, amen, whatever it's described here as the floods, the winds, amen, and all of that which is going to be coming against your life, amen, if you're founded on that sure foundation, amen, your foundation will stand. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Now, verse 26 says this, and everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand. And this is the situation many times, and when it comes to the secular world, many times everybody confessing Christ today. Everybody said, well, I go to church, I was raised in church, born in church, and amen, I believe in Christ and all of that. But the scripture says, he that doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which build his house upon the sand. So you have a person that will always what, stand up under the pressure of time. Yes. And whatever comes, whatever goes, whatever doesn't happen or happens, he's going to be what? He's going to be secure because he's all building up on that foundation. And in order to be built up on that foundation, you got to do what the Lord says do. Amen. You have to do what he says do. Is that right? Now, I know some people will do it, sometime, another time they won't, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, and down. I don't believe that God's grace, amen, you're going to receive God's best. And more than likely, you're going to forfeit all of the rewards and all of the blessings that God has. Scripture says, eye hasn't seen, neither ear heard, neither has it what? Entered into the hearts of men the things that God has prepared for them that what? Love Him. God has some astounding blessings waiting for us. Amen. Praise God. After this life is over. These are going to be rewards. How many know that when you work, you need to, amen, you want a reward? Amen. Amen. Some of y'all don't act like you want nothing. You just say, well, Lord, I want just everything I can get down here. Amen. But I want a reward. Amen. Praise God. I want to be like the Apostle Paul. I fought a good fight. I kept the faith. I'm ready to be offered up. Amen. Now, here's the thing about the foolish man which builds upon the sand. The rain descended, the floods came, the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. So we see today that many, amen, in the secular world, many of them that name the name of Christ, many of them have experienced some real adversities, and it's not just in the music and the world of our sports, but in almost across the board, you find many people that are building their house upon a weak foundation. And I believe a whole lot of it is because many times people think that when they are born again and come into church, attend church many times, they have no clue as to how to begin to build their foundation. Amen. You'd be surprised of how many churches don't teach people to build, their foundation upon the Word of God. Amen. It seems like many times everybody is just content with just what? Joining church. Amen. Joining again is not being born again. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Then after you're born again, then there's something else that God wants to do. God's primary, interest, as we always say, He wants us saved. It's God's will for man to be what? Saved.
Amen.
How many believe that? He wants us healed.
Amen.
He wants our bodies whole so that we can what? Fight a good fight. Be strong all the way to the end. Amen. Hallelujah. How many can say amen? That's the reason why God heals, because He wants us what? Strong. Amen. He's living in our temples. Is that right?
Amen.
Is that right? God lives in us.
Amen.
And the only way God can be glorified and magnified and exalted, and the only way that His name, amen, can be exalted, and even, amen, His will known, the only way is going to be through people that will declare Him and what? Reveal Him to the world. That's the only way that His ways can be known through us. So God is really concerned about our bodies. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Oh, yes, He is. Amen. That's the reason why so many scriptures in the Old Testament are devoted to healing. He sent His word and He healed. And He delivered them. And Jesus' ministry was devoted primarily to what? To healing. Because this is the universal desire of all human beings. Amen. To be what? Healed. They put more stress and emphasis on that and more desire on that than even what? Salvation. Because many times they are not cognizant. Is that right? They're not cognizant of their what? Spiritual need and deficiency. But they are cognizant of what? Their physical need. If they have got cancer eating on them, or some kind of what? Dreadful malady that's creating working havoc in their life, they're concerned about that. So the universal desire of all human beings in this world, amen, their priority is life. They want to live. How many can say amen?
Amen.
So Jesus, what He does, He says that I want my way known and my way to be revealed to all men, because I want them saved. It's my will for men to be what? Saved. And come, hallelujah, to the knowledge of the truth. That I'm good. Hallelujah. Amen. Ha, ha, ha. God wants His ways known. Touch somebody and just say, God wants His ways known. Sometimes people look up on God as being what? The bad guy.
Yeah.
A policeman type, waiting for you to what? Do something wrong so He can just swat you over your head with a what? Amen. With a blackjack or something. But God is not like man. Scripture says, amen. Hallelujah. God is good. Amen. He's not trying to take you out of here. He's trying to what? Keep you here. His eyes are running to and fro throughout the whole earth. And He's searching for people that can place themselves in a position to receive the abundance of blessings that He has. Amen. Waiting for them. He's already done all the work. Oh, God is good. So the New Testament, Jesus' teachings anyway, just saturated with what? Healing. Because that's the best way to get people what? Saved. You can get 1,000 people saved by one healing than by preaching 1,000 sermons. Amen. Because people want to be what? They want to be healed.
Amen.
Hallelujah. How many can say amen?
Amen.
All right. So God wants man saved and come to the knowledge of the truth, and then God wants man filled with the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
And these are things, okay, I'm going to just lay out the reasons why many times people in the secular world that profess Christianity, the religion, many times, they think they are dealing upon a solid foundation because they say, well, 20 years ago, I confessed Christ as my Lord and Savior. Amen. I grew up in church. Amen. But it doesn't tell anything about what they taught in their church, whether they even believed I know I'm preaching this morning. I don't know whether they even believe in what? The baptism of the Holy Ghost or not. And God is interested in not only in people getting saved, because you ain't going to stay saved long if you ain't got nothing to keep you saved. And the Holy Ghost, they told me when I was growing up, when I just first got saved, before I got saved, I grew up in the church. He said, the Holy Ghost is a keeper. He said, don't try, James, to live the life on your own. Because you'll come out to be a miserable failure. But they told me that you can do all things through Christ. Amen. Through Christ. Everybody said, I can do all things through Christ. You mean to tell me I can't do all things through Christ when I got Him living on the inside of me? When I submit to Him and yield and let Him? Jesus said, I don't do nothing of myself. It's the Father in me that doeth the work. And I can always say, I like these scriptures that deal with new creation realities. Greater is He that is in me. I'm going to be bold about it. Scriptures, see, this is another thing too. And many times when people name the name of Christ and come up to churches, many times they've never been exposed to new creation realities. They haven't been exposed to that. And you can see that many times, many believe that they are building upon a what? Solid foundation, because they throw Christ in their testimony, right? They might read their Bibles, but many times they don't have a clue as to what the Bible that they are reading are what? Saying. Very few people have a revelation of who they are in Christ. And I don't believe you can live a victorious life unless you have a revelation of who you are. I believe the most important portion of the scripture, amen. So I think that when people are saved, they need to be instructed as to what portion of the scripture should I start with to really begin to get my foundation strong. You believe that most times people are confronted with that type of issue when they first come into most churches? They just bring them into church. Sometimes they don't even get saved. Sometimes they do what? They join. They're right. Then the next thing they ask, what do you want to do in the church? And they start working in the church. On Sunday, they hear some type of consoling sermon. But yet, the meat of the word is what? Like it. And this is the main reason why many times people will never make it, never be successful. Amen. I believe that God wants us to be rich and blessed. Amen. But the scripture says, if you don't get your foundation strong, the Bible says the prosperity of fools will what? Will destroy you. The prosperity of fools will destroy you. That's what the Bible says. And a whole lot of people get destroyed because of what? Money. When they begin to what? Prosper. When they begin to soar. When they begin to experience what? Fame and a name. Amen. These are things that can really happen, amen, in the life of people, amen, if they don't have their what? Foot on solid ground. You got to have a what? Good foundation. You have to know you're saved. Be saved and know you're saved. Amen. Some said, well, my dungeon shook and my chain fell off. I know I'm born again. Amen. Well, then that got to shake. Bible says if any man be in Christ, he's a what? New. You got to have experience a what? New being on the inside. If any man be in Christ, he's a what? New creature. Old things pass away, and behold, all things are what? New. Amen. So God wants us saved, filled with the Holy Spirit, and then He wants us to grow up spiritually. Amen. Those are the three basic interests that God has. He wants all of us to what? Grow up spiritually. He wants His way known. He wants people to know that He's a kind, loving God, full of compassion, slow to anger, and of great mercy. You know, anger, amen. We know that God is a God of judgment. I don't think that we always should be magnifying is what his judgment side. Sister Hill, amen, got a judgment side if I mess up. Been married for 50 years. Amen. All I've seen basically is that the love side. One or two times, amen, that other side came in. But that was a strange act. A strange act. Y'all don't understand what I mean. Strange act means that it's something that she really didn't want to do, but I pushed her to do it. All right. So those were strange acts. But basically, amen, all of these 50 years, amen, she's been just a, just what you see here. Amen. That's the way God is. God is basically what? Kind, full of compassion, slow to anger, great mercy. He's a good God, but he does have a judgment side too. You got that right? Amen. But a lot of times, it's a long time before that judgment side kicks in. Is that right? Because the sentence against evil is not executed speedily. Sometimes we just take it for granted that God is what? He ain't gonna do nothing by us what? Acting a fool. Because he don't pull out his hatchet right away. Amen. We just let you go. The Bible says the goodness of God is designed to lead us to what? Repentance. God will just put up with you year after year. And you're just messing over him right and left. Because he's trying to get you what? Saved. He doesn't want you to die and what? Lose your soul. So when God judges a person, it's not God's nature. Judgment is not God's real nature. God's real nature. The Bible never said God is judgment. Amen. God is what? God is love. His nature basically is a love nature. Is that right? Amen. But when you push him too far, the Bible says, when he that is often reproved and hardness in shall suddenly be destroyed. That without remedy. So you don't want to push God to the brink. Amen. How many can say amen?
Amen.
You want to what? I mean, you better, you know, he got judgment, but then he got mercy. And better still, he got grace. That right, grace is God doing for something for you that you would never would have been able to do for yourself. It's all of God's love, all of his mercy, goodness, and everything that God's got. Amen. And his eager desire to what? To release it toward you. How many? Grace is the exceeding greatness of God's power.
Amen.
Amen. How many can say amen?
Amen.
So this is the God's desire is for man to grow up spiritually. In order to grow up spiritually, there's a certain aspect of God's word that you really need to focus on and just really master if you really want to feel perfectly secure. Amen. And that is the area that we've been teaching you, and we've been teaching you for the last several weeks, the Lord's compassion. I have all of that teaching about ready to pass out, but I'm not sure whether I'll just give it to you free. Because, amen, people just don't do well when you give them everything free. Amen. But the second most important area, I feel that, and it's just more or less a step beyond the area of the Lord's compassion, is God's willingness to use his power, amen, to release into us, to release into our lives all of his fullness. And all of his fullness, amen, would be God's grace. And I think that if you can master, amen, the teachings that we have done so far, the Lord's compassion, and I've given you scriptures like the Lord's eyes are running to and fro throughout the whole earth, he's seeking, amen, he's full of eager yearning. Touch somebody and say, he's full of eager yearning. He wants the blessings to come on you and overtake you more than you want the blessings yourself. Amen. Amen. God ain't a tight-fisted God. He's not a what? Tightwad. Bible says that it's his good pleasure to give you what? The kingdom. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Now, the area that I really feel that we need to master is the area of grace, because grace, scripture says, we're saved by grace. And all of the new creation realities that we are not going to, if we don't understand and those things don't become real to us, we will never be a devil master. We'll never live a life free from sin. Scripture says, sin shall not have dominion over you. See, the problem with people that is in and out, up and down, people that never seems to be able to get themselves together, never able to overcome certain habits and addictions and things of that nature, the problem is that the reality of what Christ has done for them through his redemptive work has never become real to them. And the only way they can become real to them is that they have to really begin to focus on them and really begin to what? Receive them. How many can say amen?
Amen.
So, you know, the teachings that we're doing on Wednesday night is so vital, but many times believers don't grasp the importance of Bible study. Amen. Y'all looking down at me this morning. They don't understand. Amen. We've been teaching, Sister Brenda, we've been teaching them that the reality of Christ's incarnation was very important, because if Jesus was a man and he did everything as a man, went through everything that he went through as a man, the only thing that Jesus had to rely on was the Holy Ghost. And it's the same Holy Ghost that lives in me. Scripture says how God, I can just come start praying again now. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost. It's Acts 10:38. And with power. Who went about doing good. Of the devil, for God was with him. And if only, if Jesus had at his disposal only what we have at our disposal, God was in Christ, God is in me. All the works that Jesus did, he said, I didn't do them. It was that God that dwells in me. He's the one that what? Doeth the works. Well, I got the same God. I got that same Jesus. Boy, I got the, I admit, Jesus and God is in me. And the Holy Ghost. Man, God. Now let me tell you, if all that Jesus relied on was the God on the inside and the Holy Ghost that worked through him to do the works, amen, what the reality of his incarnation will speak, will say, that if Jesus only operated through the power of the Holy Ghost, he did not use any of the inherent powers that he possessed as God when he was in his what? When he was in his what? The state of deity, when he existed as God. He laid aside all of that, and he had to operate and employ only the things that a natural person could employ in order to, amen, win the victory and to go through all that he did. Even the scripture says that he was in every point tempted as we are, yet without sin. It was because that God was in him. The Holy Ghost is the one that what gave him the strength. How many can say amen?
Amen?
He did no sin. Neither guile was found in his mouth. He was holy, harmless, undefiled, and separate from sinners. All as a man. Not using any of his what? Pre-existent powers. That shows me that when God comes and lives in me, oh, I could just cry. When Christ, the hope of glory, makes his home in my heart. When the exceeding greatness of God's power in the person of the Holy Spirit comes in me. No wonder Jesus said, greater works than these shall ye do. Amen. Oh, Jesus. The works that I do, ye shall do also. And greater works than me. In other words, there's nothing in this world. See, Jesus did not cow down to the devil. The devil never overcame him. The devil never got the upper hand on him. Because he knew that the Father was in him, and it was the Father that was what? Doing the works. Amen. That's the reason why he became our what? The propitiation for our sin. That's the reason why he was able to give his life. Amen. He was the Lamb without what? Spot. Because he overcame the devil as a man. See, this doesn't mean anything to people that don't pray. God has to show you most of what he means by praying. And this is the thing that many times we don't value. We think, well, Pastor, he'll just keep them busy. Just ask us to come to pray, come to pray, come to pray, come to pray, come to pray. Let me tell you, see, it's important for you to be in a praying church. It's important. I can give you so many scriptures now, but covering a whole lot of things supposed to be happening to a whole lot of y'all now. And they would have been happening, they would have happened a long time ago if you didn't have somebody praying like Paul prayed. I'm just going to give you, I don't have time to do it. Amen. The Ian sign came up. The end sign came up. Amen. But does it mean that? Now, remember that Sunday she spoke? And when that time was out, she said, I wasn't here. Amen. She said, I heard her on her CD. She said, give me 5 more minutes. So I'm asking for 5 more minutes. I heard her. So I remember, were you here? You should have been holding up the flag then. You missed your opportunity. I would have given you permission if you had asked me. Huh? Okay, well, see, that's the problem. Everybody want to get out early. everybody want to get out early. See, that's the problem. Everybody want to get out early. They don't want to spend much time in prayer, but prayer is when you get the revelation. Hallelujah. That's the reason I'm so happy today, because I pray when y'all sleep, when y'all watching TV, when y'all eat everything you can get your hands on. That's the reason I'm happy in this little church. Half of them don't have come. That's the reason why I'm still victorious. And I do a whole lot of good when I leave here. All right, I'm just going to give you this is the way that we need to be praying. Paul said in Colossians 4:12, laboring. So you've got to have a praying church behind you. If you want to get established real good, you've got to have a praying church that you are connected with. And that means also you've got to what, frequent the prayers. You just can't have people praying for you and you all game and you going everywhere you want to go and doing everything you want to do. And you having a ball, you having a picnic, and you got somebody what, praying for you? Amen. The reason why many times people are blessed is because these prayers that we are praying is designed to what, cover people that's under our ministry. And God is just so good. I remember when I got saved, amen, I didn't know how to live a nigga with a dog me. But I have a whole lot of saints around me praying. And I made it all right. How many can say it? You can make it.
You can make it.
You can make it. Now, here's what Paul prayed in Colossians 4. See, these are the kind of prayers that saints ought to be praying on. He says, laboring fervently for you in prayers. Prayers. That means he was praying all kind of prayers, because saints need all kind of prayers to pray. You need to pray in brokenness, travail in prayer. You need to pray in the Holy Ghost. You need to pray in what? Tongues. You need to pray what? The Word. You need to what? Pray intercession. They need all kind of prayers. Y'all know we do. See, if you can get God's people to pray, this church will come together real quick. But many times we just got so many excuses. And that's the problem behind all of your problems, all of your sicknesses, and all of your adversities. It's behind, what's behind that is negligence. Spiritual negligence. Laziness of souls. The inactivity of your spirit. Your spirit is not what? Engaging in things that can make it strong. That means the neglect of the word, the neglect of the prayer, and the neglect of doing good works. Those five things I can mention, kind of with one, amen, kind of on one hand, are the greatest contributors to spiritual growth and spiritual maturity. Okay, I said, the word, you got to have the word, right? That's the foundation that all of us would build on. But it's got to be the right word. You got to have anointed what? Teachers. You got to have somebody with some revelation. Otherwise, you can read the Bible for years and never get what you're supposed to get. Because you more than likely, if you're not really agonizing in prayer and spending some quality time in prayer and fasting and praying to get past your flesh, more than likely the word of God will never become what? Reality. And spiritual realities you'll never what? Be able to what? You'll never be able to grasp. Way is so plain, the fool won't error, but you got to but be in the spirit. How many can say amen?
Amen.
I said, pray. I say, the word, number two, you got to pray. And you got to have people praying for you, with you. You got to be in an atmosphere or an environment. You need to be in an environment to grow. Let God want you to grow. God has designed it for you to be attached to the body of Christ.
Amen.
And you need some people that's what? Praying, some serious praying. All prayer, all prayer. Y'all don't hear me. You need to be interceded for saints. This is what Paul said. He says, laboring fervently for you in prayers that ye may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. Now these are the things that we need to be saying with our mouths when we are, amen, praying for people. Pray that they might stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. Galatians 4:19, my little children, of whom I travail in birth until Christ be formed in you. So we need to pray that Christ be what? Formed. They get, amen. Form meaning Christ being formed. That means that the reality of what Christ did, of his works, really began to be what? Established in you. The Bible says that it's a good thing for us to be established in grace. So, amen. Getting established in grace just means that what you really get a revelation of who you are in Christ. Established in grace. Everybody just said, established in grace. It's a good thing. That's the reason the Bible says, grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and what? Savior, Jesus Christ. These are the kind of prayers Paul prayed. Paul prayed, he said, night and day, praying exceedingly, that we might see your face. This is 1 Thessalonians 3:10. And might perfect that which is lacking in you. So you have to have a church that's praying the right stuff for you. And if you don't know how to word it, like Paul worded it, pray it in the Holy Ghost. This is the greatest mistake and the greatest hindrance to spiritual growth I can see in the church today. Boy, it's like pulling teeth. You won't want to pull. He said, nah. It's like pulling teeth to get people to flow in the Holy Ghost. And as a result, they stay babies just about all their life. They're never get the revelation. It was quiet. You want to lay here and tell my sister, she's been praying. That's one of the biggest hindrances and barriers in the body of Christ, especially in our black churches. We don't deal too much with what tongues. Yes, I ain't gonna nothing like that come out of my mouth. I don't know what I'm saying. But Paul was praying that they might stand perfect in the will of God. How are you ever going to get perfected without praying in the Holy Ghost? Because you don't know what you need to be praying for. Amen. You don't know what's down the road ahead. Amen. A lot of your problems, you don't even understand what's going on yourself. And you're trying to deal with that old limited language. Amen. And a lot of times you don't have to know what you're saying anyway when you're trying to do it in English. If you do it in English, you ought to be intelligent enough to pray the word. So if you don't do it in the spirit, what hope do you have? That's the reason why in the church, you can have people in the church for a long time. I mean, in Northside Christian Center, they have come to Bible study. Hey, amen. Y'all got to love me now because half of y'all don't. I ain't got nothing personally against you, Sister Wayne. I know you work. At night. I know a lot of folk work at night. I don't have nothing against you. Sister Elam, you probably say, well, I'm old. I'm retired. I got to stay home with my husband. I give him some space. All right. All right. I'll give him some space. Oh, hallelujah. How many can say praise the Lord? But let me tell you, praying in the Holy Ghost is much more than you have ever imagined. It has more to do with your spiritual growth because the word has to be received, but the word has to be what? Watered. It has to be prayed into reality. Y'all okay? You have to pray it into reality. You have to pray it until it becomes real. You have to pray it until it's quicker. So you're going to have saints praying for you. And you're going to have what? You're going to pray your lazy self. It's nothing but laziness. It's just neglect. We'll be babies. I mean, we'll be 65 years old with a ball in our mouths. In the nursery. Gray-haired baby. How would that look in the nursery? A gray-haired 65-year-old person with a bottle in their mouth. All they can take is what? Milk. The milk. All right. I've given you three, right? Let me see. I gave you the word. I gave you what? Prayer. The third thing I wanted to give you is that I better end. All right, but here's the thing. If you never get these things that I'm going to be sharing the next time or two in place, your foundation is just going to be like the man that built his house upon the wood, on the sand. It's not going to last. Oh, I got some more. Oh, they said, I sure want to go. Amen. Sister Hill said, next Sunday. She just tried to get me down anyway. All right. She said, everybody said, praise the Lord. Well, this is so real. You know, I think I did a pretty good job on conveying the Lord's compassion. Well, I got a whole lot of pages that lays it out. the healing part, all of his mercy. I just got laid out really, really, really good. How many can't wait to get it? So you can just lay it down somewhere. All right. All right, but now, Sister Candy, I'm focusing on this Graves thing. Who we are. I got to wear this thing out. I got to get this just right. If we don't get this just right, amen, it ain't going to happen for us. These signs supposed to what? Follow them. Amen. Woo, glory. How many want signs followed? How many want to see God confirm his word with signs followed? That's what I'm hungry for. How many are hungry for reality? Amen. How many want to see miracles? People will come down. We won't have no problem filling this church up if we had what? Miracles. But Pastor Hill can't do it by him what? Himself. Amen. If 3/4 of y'all slumbering and what? Sleeping.